Chapter 15. Farewells. With some deft handling of the controls and some help from Romana, the Doctor brought the TARDIS into a hovering orbit at a safe distance from the rapidly altering planet 11. The police box materialized soundlessly. Aboard the craft, Spigot and Stokes were slumped against a wall of the control room. Stokes had decided merely to accept the impossible dimensions of the interior. His concern from the very start of this deplorable business had been to escape, and it would be ill-mannered to complain about the means. And he was quite simply beyond gaping.
"Do you know," said Spigot, "if there's one thing this affair has taught me, it's this."
Stokes raised a sarcastic eyebrow.
"Never doubt the word of a time-traveling robot, dog!"
Spigot ignored the quip.
"It's shown me that when it really comes down to it, when your life's on the line and the odds are against you, well, perhaps there's something more important than just staying alive."
He nodded.
"Soon as I get back to 5, I'm going after Angie and the kids. I'll find them, no matter how long it takes."
Stokes frowned.
"I don't understand. Surely you'll find them where you left them."
Well, I didn't actually leave them," Spigot confessed. "I came back from a case one day and they'd upped and left me. I still don't really know why."
"Don't you?"
said Stokes, rather amused. He let his large, bald head fall back against the curiously warm and humming wall. At the console, the Doctor was removing a set of leads from K9.
"How are you feeling?"
The dog's head snapped up and his eye screen glowed a healthy red.
"Fully recharged, Master. Energy banks at 89% capacity."
The Doctor rubbed his hands.
"Excellent. And how about you, Romana?"
She looked up from the readout she was studying.
"Oh, fine. There's no need to worry. It was an unpleasant experience, but I remembered my training in resistance to outward telepathic interference."
She held up a hand before her eyes.
"I threw up a screen. She could use my body, but she couldn't see into my mind."
"How jolly clever!"
The Doctor patted her on the back.
"It's nice to know that the Academy are passing on useful information like that. Things were very different in my day, you know."
"Oh, I didn't mean my academy training, Doctor," Romana smiled. "I meant my training from you."
K9 spoke.
"Master, materialization in hover mode has now been achieved, and TARDIS is stable."
"Good, good."
The Doctor twisted the scanner control, and the shutters slid open. Planet 11 lay below them, its entirety revealed by the scanner's powerful image translator. Its transmission was complete. The stodgy blueness had been replaced by a layer of shining silver that coated the surface completely, and it now resembled a Christmas bauble, or ball bearing, spinning helplessly in its orbit. Intrigued, Spigot and Stokes joined them before the screen.
"Is it really living?"
Stokes asked.
"Not as such," Romana replied. "Not what you'd call life."
The Doctor looked less certain. "But life, like death, is a very difficult state to define."
He reached out to close the shutters, but Spigot laid a hand on his arm and pointed in wonder at the image.
"Doctor, look!"
On the surface of the planet, a shape was forming. Indistinct at first, the swirling helicon surged upward in a huge but recognizable pattern. The face of Zaius, twisted, snarling, and spread across half the surface area of the planet. Somehow, they all heard her voice, as her mouth, larger than the mountain range, opened. Her angry voice echoed telepathically up to them from the planet.
"No, Doctor! I order you to return! Puny normal, I will crush you! You will be my new host! I shall create an army from the power gathered here!"
Sadly, the Doctor reached out and twisted the scanner control. The shutters slid to, and the voice faded with the image. Stokes shuddered.
"Well, she looks rather active."
The Doctor smiled.
"Don't worry, she's trapped there. Without a host, she's got no hope of going anywhere. And her telepathic powers aren't strong enough to reach out at that distance."
He turned to the two men.
"I think it's time we saw about getting you gentlemen home."
The main hall outside the courtrooms was much as the fleeing crew of the Rock had left it. Evidence of the Ogron attack was limited to an occasional beam-scarred pillar or bust, and it could have been that the sabotage attempt engineered by Spigot and K9 had caused more damage to property. A blue beacon began to flash in midair, and a few seconds later, the police box shell of the TARDIS had solidified from transparency. The doors opened and the Doctor, Romana, K9, Spigot, and Stokes emerged. All of them looked rather battered after their recent ordeals. The Doctor extended a hand to Stokes.
"Well, I'm afraid this is where we must say goodbye. I hope your artistic career continues to flourish, despite the obvious drawbacks."
Stokes shook the hand warmly and said pettishly,
"A good craftsman will succeed in whatever circumstances." "That's exactly what I meant."
The Doctor patted Spigot on the shoulder.
"Goodbye. Try to keep clear of any trouble in future."
"Hang about," said Spigot. "What about Planet 11? What are we going to do about that? We can't have Zaya shouting at passers-by. It'll put the tourists right off."
"A good point."
The Doctor ferreted in his pocket and produced a scrap of paper and a stub of blunt pencil. He scribbled down a complex formula and passed it to Spigot.
"Tell your boffins to have a go with that. Should break down the helicon molecules fairly quickly."
"Provided that the beam is directed at a convex angle," Romana reminded him.
There was a clatter of booted footsteps along the corridor. Two men in black uniform were approaching. The taller of the two raised a blaster and cried,
"Halt! Who are you?"
Spigot reached inside his jacket and brought out his wallet, which he flipped open to reveal his warrant.
"It's okay, boys. Frank Spigot here. I've got the whole situation under control."
The uniformed policeman lowered his gun.
"Hello, sir. Who are these people? Have you seen the High Archon?"
"Don't worry, they're friendly enough." Spigot stepped forward. "As for old man Pierpoint, well, you won't be seeing him again. Polished off, along with Zaius and the Nisbet brothers."
The officer boggled.
"Zaius? And the Nisbet brothers?"
"Right enough. These people were kind enough to help me, and I recommend the highest civilian citation."
He turned to indicate the others, but the Doctor had already stepped hurriedly back into the TARDIS, K9 at his heels. Romana gave a little wave to Stokes and followed them. The officer scratched his head.
"Why are they going in that box?"
The answer came a moment later as the TARDIS dematerialized.
"Well, it's not important," said Spigot, thinking quickly as ever. "You'd never believe me if I told you. The important thing is the menace is over, and I can tell you a thing or two about what's been going on out here."
He walked away with the officers. Stokes lingered behind, listening to Spigot beginning to relate the story of how he personally had dealt with the biggest criminal conspiracy of the decade.
"Finally, finally, I am going to be sick," he said.
"Do you think Spigot will pass on the formula?" Romana asked later, a little worried.
The Doctor was rifling through some yellowing star charts. He held up one triumphantly, peered at a particular area, and grinned.
"Yes, here, look."
Romana examined the chart.
"The Uva Beta Uva system, surveyed 50 years after we left. And Planet 11 is just a ball of rock. Good."
K9 trundled forward, tail wagging anxiously. He said.
"We have not finished the game."
"Ah, yes, the Monopoly."
Romana looked over to the board and reminded herself of the state of play.
"I'm just about to win."
The Doctor unwound his scarf, shook off his coat, and draped them over the stand.
"The trouble with Monopoly is that it's far too simple. The mind wanders."
"It won't take a moment," said Romana.
The Doctor made for the inner door.
"I've more important things to do anyway."
"Oh, really?"
"Yes," the Doctor retorted. "For a start, there's the..."
He grinned.
"Well, I'll think of something."
You have been listening to Doctor Who, The Missing Adventures, The Romance of Crime, written by Gareth Roberts. Read by Marcus Cotton. Directed and edited by Brian Corrigan. Produced by Brian Corrigan and Joey Morgan. Sound design was by Brian Corrigan. Executive producer, Joey Morgan. This is a fan-made audiobook for Security Kitchen Productions and is in no way associated with the BBC, Big Finish Productions, Audible, or the Doctor Who license.